Hello, this is Nima Golbabai on Cineshow, KUCI 88.9 Irvine. It's good to be back here, Wednesdays from 4 to 5, as usual. Like I said last time, we're going to be ramping up to Christmas, which means I'm going to be doing a bunch of different movies, and some favorites, some new ones, and whatnot. But I first had to do The Nightmare Before Christmas because I promised I'd watch it, and I fulfilled that promise. And yeah, so I'm going to review that right now. The Nightmare Before Christmas is written by Tim Burton, but I believe it's directed by someone else. And let me pull that up here using IMDb as usual for me. Okay. Nightmare Before Christmas was written by Tim Burton and directed by Henry Selick, who I have no idea who that is, but... Oh, okay, he directed Coraline. That makes sense. Alright, Nightmare Before Christmas is a really good movie. I just finished watching it. It's sort of like a Halloween Christmas movie, which is good because we're in November, I guess, which is in between Halloween and Christmas, so you could say November babies maybe have some dark side and some light side in them. I don't know. The actors in this movie, the voice actors, I'm not really familiar with too many of them, but I think I know Catherine O'Hara. Just want to pull up her here, see who it is. Okay, no, I don't know her. Anyway, let's just get into it. This movie made me smile a lot. I really liked it. It's like a very good movie. I haven't really watched too many stop-motion movies, but this one was like really, really cool, and I loved all the character designs. I especially liked the female lead, which was Sally, who was like a sort of Frankenstein, but She's like a doll, and her arm falls off, and she can sew herself back together. And I also like the Santa Claus. But the plot of The Nightmare Before Christmas is, Jack Skellington, who's the king of Halloween Town, stumbles upon Christmas Town, and he sort of is, how should you say, he sort of falls in love with it, and he wants to bring Christmas to Halloween Town, or he wants to like be Santa Claus for Christmas. So this is all confusing to the people of Halloween Town, as you might expect, and they don't really get it, but he's the king, so they follow what he says, and they make a bunch of preparations to do gift giving, but Jack Skellington is going to do it. So first step is to eliminate Santa Claus. But don't worry, they don't kill him. They just friendly kidnap him. I don't wanna... It's not in a bad way, let's say. They just sort of transport him to a new location, and then Jack Skellington becomes Santa Claus for a day. But the problem is he doesn't really know the traditions of Christmas, so he delivers like you know, like, I don't even know I can say this, but like, let's say people's heads. It's a kid's movie, but it sounds worse when I say it. To like little kids, and they scream, and then everyone's like, oh my god, this is not Santa Claus. And then the military shoots him down in his sleigh, and he crashes. And then he realizes the error of his ways, goes saves Santa Claus. And then he falls in love with Sally. I don't really know if it's falling in love, but yeah, I guess it is. But it's not a traditional romance. And yeah, that's how the movie ends. It's a really sweet movie that I really liked, and it made me smile a lot. Mainly because of the animation style and like the visual jokes that were in the movie. Like I said about the stop motion, it's really, really well done, and it's kind of cool to see an animated movie that's a little bit different than every other movie that comes out these days, which is like the same sort of soulless 3D animation that's a little annoying at times, although I know it's sort of easier to make and maybe a bit more realistic, I guess. But it would be cool if every once in a while they could mix it up. And this was nice to see. Furthermore, what I really liked about this movie is I thought it was quite entertaining and the songs were really good. It's a musical and it was just kind of a it was kind of a sweet concept, like a scary evil skeleton sort of guy like falls in love with Christmas just by seeing the colors and the bright lights, and he sort of tries to figure out why people love it so much, like if it's some conspiracy, but then he just, decides he wants to be Santa Claus and whatnot. And I guess that probably is the experience of most people with Christmas. I certainly know that's how I feel. I like it a lot, and I don't really know why. But yeah, this was a really nice movie. It's a short movie, it's not too heavy on plot, but it's really fun to watch because of the animation and the little jokes throughout. Although the story is quite nice and it's sweet, and a lot of the characters are really like kind of cute, the designs are really nice. And yeah, I really like it. It's the perfect movie in between Halloween and Christmas for you to watch this November. And moving up to Christmas. Yeah. But I have some other movies I'd like to talk about on this nice episode today. However, my computer is not working. I was going to play a few songs from the movie, but unfortunately, I'm going to have to fix that for a second. I'll play a little filler song in the meantime, but just in about a minute, I will play you two songs from the movie, and then we'll get on to some other movies, and I'll come back to The Nightmare Before Christmas and we'll talk about it a bit more, but for now, I want to play you a few songs. All right, bear with me.
And spiders in my hair.
This is Halloween, this is Halloween, 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 Halloween.
In this town we call home, everyone hail to the pumpkin song.
In this town, don't we love it now? Everybody's waiting for the next surprise.
London,
can. Something's waiting at a punch and pull.
Hooray! This is Halloween!
Red and black.
It's bloody green.
Aren't you scared?
Well, that's just fine.
Say it once, say it twice. Take a chance and roll the dice. Ride with the moon in the dead of night.
Everybody scream! Everybody scream!
In our town of Halloween.
I am the clown with the tearaway face.
Here in a flash and follow the trace.
There. I am the wind blowing through your hair.
I am the shadow on the moon at night, filling your dreams to the brim with fright.
This is Halloween, this is Halloween, 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 Halloween. Halloween.
Tender rumblings everywhere. Life's no fun without a good scare.
That's our job,
but we're not mean.
In our town of Halloween.
In this town,
don't we love it now? Everyone's waiting for the next surprise.
Skeleton Jack might catch you in the back and
scream like a bat, you make you jump out of your skin.
This is Halloween, everybody scream.
Won't you please make way for a very special guy?
Lawman Jack is king of the pumpkin patch. Everyone hail to the pumpkin king.
This is Halloween.
Okay, that was This Is Halloween, which is the sort of signature song, let's say, of The Nightmare Before Christmas. It plays in the opening credits, which has awesome animation. I recommend you search it up. It's really cool. And it made me excited to watch the rest of the movie, which is always a good sign. My favorite opening credits of a movie, which is a good thing to talk about because I never hear anybody talk about it. I think my favorite ones are Terminator 2, with like when the camera is slowly panning across the playground on fire with the music in the background. That was really cool. And then I also like, I'm forgetting what it was, but I had another one that was my favorite, but I can't remember, but that was one of my favorites. Best end credits for a movie, another hard one that nobody talks about, but it has to be Kill Bill, that has the most awesome ending credits of any movie because it goes through every single character and gives them like a huge awesome action sequence ending that's like really cool edited, and it's all awesome. Another good one, opening credits, is Battle Royale, which is a Japanese film I recently watched. That one's really cool because it's very anime-like and it's really fun to watch. But I have this theory that the opening credits of a movie hypes you up for everything you see, and I feel like they're important, especially for like an action movie. I think they should be like really, really exciting. That's my theory anyway. But back to The Nightmare Before Christmas. There's probably a few more things we should talk about with this. It was released in 1993. It doesn't feel like that. It feels like it's so like crisp and clean. Not that movies from the... I don't want to sound like an idiot that thinks, like, old movies are... I don't think that, but I'm just saying it didn't look like a 90s movie to me. It seemed very, like, new, and it all seemed, like, on the cutting edge, really. And I was just reading here some trivia for the movie. Tim Burton said the movie was inspired after seeing Halloween merchandise in the store being taken down and replaced by a Christmas display. The juxtaposition of ghouls and goblins with Santa and his reindeer sparked his imagination, and I think that's a good thing about Tim Burton. He seems to like have this crazy brain, sort of like David Lynch, I think, because they're both like these crazy dudes, and they just come up with these insane stories that are very weird. And this was sort of the perfect movie for Tim Burton, because he likes a lot of weird-looking characters and weird-looking things, and stop motion's like the ultimate way to make something look weird. Going back to Terminator and Terminator 1, the original Terminator units were stop motion, and it makes them look so much more creepy and like inhuman and stuff, and I think that it worked really well for this movie to make it sort of look odd and kind of strange. But yeah, very good movie. I liked it a lot. It's a really good Christmas movie, but I think it's good for November personally. Maybe late November, so you're getting excited for Christmas but you still remember Halloween. Speaking of Halloween, I left out a bowl for people out of the goodness of my heart to give candy to people, and I come back the next day and like the bowl is gone. It was plastic, so it's okay. The bowl is gone, all the candy's gone. I'm fine with the candy being gone, but when the bowl is gone, that makes me think some guy just took the whole thing, which is kind of annoying, right? But you know, it's fine. I saw these things on Twitter where this whole family came up to a bowl on Halloween, and the mother was like, come on, go get it all. I'm just like wondering, like, where do these people, it's like, it's not like money falling from the sky, it's just candy. But they were like eating it like vultures. Like, they weren't eating it, they were stealing it, but what's the difference? At the end of the day, you know where it went. Okay, I'm rambling. Okay, next movie I want to talk about, which I saw for the second time recently, and I should talk about it because it's a very good movie. It's Breakfast at Tiffany's, which is starring Audrey Hepburn and also George Peppard, who I'm not really familiar with, but I think he's a decently famous actor. Actually, looking at his movies, he's not that famous. I think, he's Matlock, which I think was a detective show. Oh, no, that's Andy Griffith. What am I talking about? He was in Matlock. Oops. Okay. Anyway, yeah, going back to Breakfast at Tiffany's. It's a really good romance movie. I don't typically watch romance movies, but I know a good one when I see it. Sorry, I just saw one of my friends. I haven't seen him in a while. Anyway, it's a really good romance movie, although I don't typically watch romance movies. I know a good one when I see it. It's from a book, I think, by Truman Capote, I believe. And it sort of is the story of I don't know how else to put it, but a gold digger is the modern term for what she is. She basically is always looking for a man with lots of money. And she moves into this new apartment, and she's this sort of larger-than-life woman that dresses and looks like she's far more wealthy than certainly her apartment would suggest, and so it's this whole weird thing. And then she has this neighbor who's a writer, who's actually I want to say this in a clean way, but he's also in a similar situation where he sells himself to women for money. And this is sort of at the end of the Hays Code, so you can see sort of like some more unsavory things coming in that's less very clean, and everybody is like a good moral person. We see some weird lifestyles And yeah, she's always on the move looking for a new sort of rich mate, and he's there sort of, their relationship is always developing in the background, but he can never really, they can never admit to each other that they like each other. And the film, the great thing about the film is A, it's shot really beautiful, B, it's like a really compelling romance with a really good ending scene that's pretty actually emotional for a movie that isn't, like, it's not really a heart-wrenching movie. It's more supposed to just be like a sweet love story. Yet it works so well because she plays this sort of, she plays a very friendly character, but is sort of like unwilling to be real with people. And a line from the movie is, she's a phony, but she's a real phony. Like, she's honest about it. And then in the ending scene, there's no point in really saying what she does, but she does something that's quite cold, and like, you kind of hate her at that moment. But then, like, it turns around, and they get together in the rain, and they kiss, and it's a really, really nice ending scene. But the last thing that makes this movie so good is Audrey Hepburn, who's, like, the epitome of a star. And she's just, she's not only beautiful, but a great actress. She sort of has the best costume or outfits in this movie. She's so compelling, you can't really take your eyes off her or stop listening to her throughout the whole movie. And yeah, she's just, it's rare that you get a woman or a man that you can't imagine the movie without. I don't know anyone else who could play this role, because she's like sort of like a true princess, yet she's not at all like wealthy or upper class, but she just has this like power to everything. And yeah, I'm just looking at some of the other actors in this movie, seeing if I know any to talk about here. Oh yeah, okay, Mickey Rooney is in this movie, and if any of you know Mickey Rooney, he's was known as the biggest star in the world. And he was in, if you can believe it, 300 movies. He was one of those guys that never stopped working. He lived to 93 because guys like that always do. You know, they're always like, oh, you gotta retire and you gotta relax. And invariably, that's never true. So this guy worked into his 90s, and he was in 300 movies, and he was in this movie Breakfast at Tiffany's, and he plays sort of this very racially stereotypical character. Like, he's playing a Japanese man who's like a comic relief character, very politically incorrect today, but that's like what he's famous for. And if you look at his movies, he's essentially in no famous movies minus Breakfast at Tiffany's and It's a Mad, Mad, Mad World. And it's just crazy, you can be in 300 movies and nearly all of them are lost to history and completely irrelevant. And it's a case of quality over quantity, I guess. But yeah, Mickey Rooney, known as the biggest star in the world, is in this movie, and he sort of plays like this, okay, sort of comic relief character, but he's sort of in there as, he's in there like as a, I guess it's like a nudge nudge wink wink kind of thing is what I get from it, because he's not really the most important character, but he's sort of just, he lightens the mood a little bit. I'm just looking at pictures of him. It doesn't look so good. It looks like all the years got to him at the end. Alright, but I'm going to play another song from Nightmare Before Christmas, and we'll continue on.
Don't do this! naughty children never get any presents.
I think he might be too big.
No, he's not. If he can go down a chimney, he can fit down here.
Santa Claus, huh? Ooh, I'm really scared. So you're the one everybody's talking about. You're joking. I can't believe my eyes. You're joking me. You gotta be. This can't be the right guy. He's ancient. He's ugly. I don't know which is worse. I might just split a seam now if I don't die laughing first. Mr. Oogie Boogie says there's trouble close at hand. You better pay attention now, cause I'm the boogeyman. And if you aren't shaking, there's something very wrong, cause this may be the last time you hear the boogie song. Whoa, whoa.
Now, or you must face the dire consequences. The children are expecting me, so please come to your senses.
Ah, you're joking! You're joking! I can't believe my ears! Would someone shut this fella up? I'm drowning in my tears. It's funny! I'm laughing! You really are too much. And now, with your permission, I'm going to do my stuff.
What are you going to do?
I'm going to do the best I can. What? Music in the air, cause I'm a gambling boogeyman, although I don't play fair. It's much more fun, I must confess, with lives on the line. Not mine, of course, but yours, oh boy. Now that'd be just fine.
Release me fast, or you will have to answer for this heinous act.
Oh, brother, you're something. You put me in a spin. You aren't comprehending the position that you're in. It's hopeless. You're finished. You haven't got a prayer. Cause I'm Mr. Oogie Boogie, and you ain't going nowhere.
All right, another song. This one was called Oogie Boogie Song. Okay, but I thought I have to talk about this 100%. This is really important stuff. I can't forget about it. All right, we gotta talk about The Marvels, a movie that I did not even realize was coming out today. Not today, but in 2 days. And I don't think half the world knew this movie was coming out, or 90% of it, because I don't think there's been a more dreaded movie in the MCU than The Marvels. A movie that will most likely flop so hard that I don't know what Disney's gonna do. I mean, after the never-ending diminishing returns of literally every single property they've acquired in the past 10 years, we got The Marvels, which is a sequel to the least popular MCU movie, certainly of the first three phases, which were genuinely like great moments of cinema. And I know a lot of people hate superhero movies that like movies. You know, they're always like, oh, you can't watch superhero movies. I don't think that's true. But yeah, this is a sequel to Captain Marvel, and such an unpopular character that they didn't even bother giving her own namesake sequel. They had to add two other characters nobody's ever heard of from the Disney Plus shows that nobody watches, that basically are losing subscribers, and obviously don't pay for anything, so they're sort of money pits. The whole streaming economy, low budget, terrible shows. So you got from the WandaVision show one character that nobody really cared for, and then you got, I don't even remember the name of the show, but Kamala Khan is the other person. Oh, from Ms. Marvel, another show that flopped that nobody liked. They put those two characters to, like, steal the limelight, hoping people will, like, watch it if they don't call it Captain Marvel. I don't really understand this logic at all. And another thing that I find worrying about this movie, it's an hour 45, which is, like, never the case with Marvel movies. They're always longer than that, which tells me they've probably butchered this movie in the editing room to make it watchable. Because it probably was so bad. Because they've delayed it, I think, like, what, a year or something? And they've probably done a bunch of reshoots and a bunch of terrible edits, and it's going to be really choppy and really hard to watch. And what I do nowadays is I don't even watch Disney movies in theaters because I don't want to give them any money. So I just wait. And I know this is going to sound dumb, but I watch it on Disney Plus, and I know I'm giving them money. But I also, I need Disney Plus to get, like, all the old Star Wars content and the old, like, MCU content. So it's not like I'm paying for nothing. But I don't want to go to the theater if I can just wait and sort of get my money's worth. I don't like paying for it as it is. But yeah, let's read some headlines about the Marvels. New York Post says, The Marvels review, the worst MCU movie yet. That's saying something, because almost all of their movies have been bad in recent memory. Let's see. From Forbes, it says, The Marvels arrives as the third worst reviewed MCU movie ever. So that's got to be with The Eternals and... Oh, Ant-Man and the Wasp. Movie I didn't see, but I watched some reviews, and it seemed like a real, just a huge L. I just don't bother watching them anymore because there's no, like, cohesive story, and there's no interesting story, so I don't care at all. And this is coming from a person that watched every single MCU movie for the first three phases, basically all of them, in the theater. Minus the Ant-Man movies, which I also didn't... They're okay. But those movies also were, like, didn't really have a cohesive story. Okay, let's see. Yeah, Eternals and Ant-Man are the two other ones. Then Love and Thunder. Multiverse of Madness. And then there's a few other old MCU movies that should not be this low compared to all these other terrible films. Let's read some other headlines here. Okay, Roger Ebert. Let's see what Roger Ebert says. He's dead. I should say that now. But some lady that works for him gives it a 1.5 out of 4 stars. Okay. You know, that's not too bad. Washington Post says it does not live up to its name. Well, okay, whatever that means. Okay, the Seattle Times says, a likable superhero trio takes us on a joyride. Huh. Well, that's nice. The Marvels aims for a $60 million debut, one of the lowest MCU box office starts. Yeah, this movie is going to be really, really disastrous for Disney. Because if you don't know, and I didn't know this for a while... But when you look at the box office compared to the budget, you would assume once a film makes up its budget, so let's say you have a $100 million budget and you make a $100 million box office, you would assume that it has broken even and everything else is profit, but this is not the case. Because, you know, you have, first of all, you have advertising budget, which is usually equal to the budget you've spent on the movie, so it's now $200 million. Then the theaters take a cut, and then you have to pay back all your investors. So usually a film has to make 3 to 3.5 times its budget to make a profit, especially with these Disney movies that spend a lot and finance a lot and stuff like that. Smaller movies usually not like this bad. So this movie is like definitely going to be a flop just based on this, but I think it'll be a worse flop than anything we've seen so far from Disney, because they've had a lot of flops. Okay, what else? Los Angeles Times says, of course the Los Angeles Times. The Marvel's review, female-centric fun for a series in need. So they're saying this is going to turn it around. Let's see about that. IndieWire says, scattered charm can't save the MCU. Okay. Nothing can save the MCU at this point. Certainly not the least popular character of the MCU. I don't know why people think that. What else here? According to comicbookmovie.com, it has a game-changing post-credits scene. Hollywood Reporter says the Marvels divides movie critics. Breezy fun versus abject misery. Ooh, abject misery. I wonder if anyone said that about, like, any of the other Phase 1 through 3 movies. I don't think it ever got that low. Okay. Abject misery. That's a really good review. Polygon says, what you need to watch before you see the movie. So, it used to be where you could just watch, like, the movies that came before to, like, get the whole picture. Or even you could just not watch the movies and still enjoy it. But now that they, like, keep bringing in characters and plot points from their low-budget, terrible TV shows, you have to sit through hours of terrible content on Disney Plus in order to understand the movie. I'd rather just not understand the movie because nobody cares. Screen Rant says, delightfully fun MCU entry. It's a much needed return to form. It's a return to form, everybody. That's great. Screen Rant says, does the Marvels have a post-credit scene, and how many? No spoilers. Okay. I don't think a lot. These are not even turning into reviews anymore. They're just rumors, I guess. Okay, this is a good one. AP, Associated Press, says that it's a low-stakes Marvels. So the movie is low-stakes, which is a good point that I'd like to talk about. The reason that people were so invested in Phase 1 through 3 of the MCU is because the stakes were so high, and they kept, like, finding ways to increase the stakes while maintaining your interest. And pathetically, the new MCU movies, the only way they've thought of making it high stakes is doing the whole multiverse thing, which completely dumbs down all the movies and makes it really difficult to understand. And essentially, in effect, what it does is it breaks the rules of the entire series, which, if you know anything about, like, a good story, it's gotta have rules. Because once you destroy the rules, nobody cares. It reminds me of Rise of Skywalker, the last fake Star Wars movie. In that movie, they completely destroyed the Force, which let's just say is magic in the Star Wars universe. And they made it where you could, like, resurrect anyone or heal anyone or teleport objects or, like, go on a FaceTime call using the Force. And all of this had no build-up. It had no setup. It wasn't seen in any other movie. It completely broke the audience's trust in what they were seeing. And it basically created a situation where you can't be invested in any of the threats and dangers that a movie puts forward if there are no rules. And especially with these movies with, like, magic, let's say, like, the Force or superhero powers. Once you start bringing in stuff that doesn't make common sense, that isn't built up in any way, and just isn't introduced in any of the other movies, nobody cares anymore. And the terrible comeback you see from, like, Disney Star Wars fans or, like, MCU shills is like, this is a story with superheroes and force magic, and you're complaining about rules, is like, no, within the universe, there are established rules. No one's saying that magic is real, but there has to be some rules for you to get invested in a series. If they had started Star Wars where the Force was like crackpot healing magic and no characters could die without being healed and brought back, nobody would care. It wouldn't have gone anywhere. But once you start changing those things, it just ruins the entire vibe. And the quantum verse, or whatever they call it, multiverse mania, it totally ruined the whole series, because now there's no permanence to anything. And the only time they did something like that where it actually worked was in Endgame, where they introduced time travel. But it was built up through two Ant-Man movies and built up sufficiently in Endgame. Plus, it was already, like, a given that, like, that's how they would defeat Thanos. Everybody knew it going in. But the problem with the multiverse was, like, unending threats coming from everywhere in the world. And, you know, with Kang, you can fight him a million times and he keeps coming back, and there's no permanence to defeating him. It just ruins it. You don't care about any of the stories they put on because you know they're all fake. And yes, they are made up stories, but they should have a degree of realism. Which I think, you know, the MCU did actually pretty well making outlandish, like, Norse gods and superheroes look real in our frame of reality. Yeah, Star Wars is a different thing, but I think Star Wars does realism, like, way better than even these other ones in our own frame of reference, and it's out of our frame of reference, and it's in a different universe with different rules, yet it's somehow more realistic. I'm talking about George Lucas Star Wars, not Disney Star Wars, obviously. Let's continue with the Marvels. Let's see what else they have to say. The Observer says, thankfully, no superhero fatigue here. Yeah, they keep talking about superhero fatigue, like people just want to be done with superhero movies, like they just don't care anymore. Which is definitely true, but it's also, like, not the full truth. People are fine with more superhero movies as long as they're, like, they actually have to be good and, like, they have to be in the same spirit of what's came before, because now they're totally soulless. The stories have no like human emotion in them whatsoever. And they're generally just, they look a lot uglier. They have way cheaper actors and actresses. More unlikable characters. It's a whole package of things that creates so-called superhero fatigue. Alright, moving on. Let's see what else. Okay, Mashable says, the Marvels, Miss Marvel tries to rescue the MCU from itself. This is another thing. You'll notice a lot of these headlines is talking about rescuing the MCU, but they've picked a totally terrible movie to do it. Who thought that this movie would ever rescue the MCU? And I've heard this, like, with 5 movies in a row, which is not a good sign. When you keep needing a new movie to, like, get people's interest, but they're, you know, these movies are, like, storyboarded and made, like, 5 years in advance, and they're all made by, like, a committee, and a very untalented committee nowadays, with that's very overworked, if you just look at the CGI animators, for instance, it's been pretty well established. They're all, like, overworked and probably underpaid. And that's because they've decided to, like, churn out movies and shows at a rate that's not possible to maintain quality. Disney got a little bit, you know, they got, what do you say, it's like their heads got too big. After Endgame, they made so much money, they were like, okay, now we can just make a bunch of junk, and people will take all the junk, and they'll love it, and they'll never stop loving it. And that was not true. Okay. Consequence.com says it's packed with plot holes and kitty cats. Plot holes are very common for these new Marvel movies. Okay. Chicago Tribune says Brie Larson gets some help this time from two characters nobody's heard of, though. They always, was she, like, yeah, people didn't like Captain Marvel, but the answer is not to add two characters that nobody's ever heard of. I don't even know why she needed a sequel in the first place. I don't know. Let's see. Alright, let's read this article. This is movies and shows to watch before the Marvels. So you watch Captain Marvel, it says. Then you move on to Miss Marvel, which is like, I think, okay, it's 6 episodes. You have to watch this. Then you gotta watch WandaVision, which is probably like 10 episodes. Then you gotta watch Secret Invasion, which is probably like 10 episodes. And then it says, I guess you just watch a few other movies to see Nick Fury, like Guardians of the Galaxy, Far From Home. Okay, whatever. But you see, this is the problem. If you gotta watch 3 shows just to see a mediocre movie, like, this is almost like a job. You should get paid if you have to watch this much stuff just to enjoy the new Marvel movie, which was often said to be, like, just easy entertainment. Now it comes with a whole to-do list of things you gotta do. You gotta check off all the shows, all the episodes of terrible shows that are really low budget. All for, like, no reward. Sad. Alright, but we're coming on the end here of our episode today. But maybe let's just go back to Nightmare Before Christmas, and I can give a last plug to the movie that I'd like you to watch this November. Let's say late November, so moving into Christmas. It's a really nice movie. It's about 1 hour and 10 minutes. It's from 1993, written by Tim Burton. It's not directed by him, but it really looks like it was. I think the reason it wasn't is because maybe he doesn't have animation experience. It's starring Danny Elfman, Chris Sarandon, Catherine O'Hara. Also has Paul Rubens, that died recently. Pee-wee Herman, of course. It's a really good movie. It has a really nice animation style. It's super sweet and, like, kind of, it's like a special movie, I would say. And it's got a lot of funny jokes, visual quips. It's quite entertaining for a short runtime. It's a nice movie to watch before Christmas. It's got a really unique story. It's, like, got that weird Tim Burton vibe that I really like to see. It's sort of got a similar vibe to, it's like a musical version of Edward Scissorhands mixed with Christmas and Halloween. So yeah, a very good film, and you should watch it. It's a nice, entertaining little movie. It's on Disney Plus. I know I haven't been so nice to Disney, but I think it's okay if you get Disney Plus, because at least there are some good old movies on there, even if nothing new that comes out is any good. At least the old movies are pretty good. But yeah, that's been a nice time. We've discussed diverse array of movies, The Nightmare Before Christmas, Breakfast at Tiffany's, The Marvels, and the MCU at large. But thank you for watching, or listening, I should say. This has been Nima Golbabai on KUCI 88.9 Irvine on my show, Cine Show. Thank you, and I'm with you to the end of the line.